Grazie. Allora, stavo dicendo grazie a tutti per essere venuti qui e per la pazienza che già ora avete dimostrato. È un piacere avervi a partecipare al festeggiamento per i 25 anni di vita e pensiero. Un ringraziamento ancora più intenso va ai relatori che onorano questa giornata con i loro studi e un ulteriore speciale ringraziamento all'organizzatore della festa, il dottor Mottola, che ha invitato, che ha organizzato, che ha pensato questo modo di celebrare i 25 anni. Facendolo guardando al futuro, piuttosto, dicevo, che al passato, che pure è un passato che segna una storia nobile, la quale avrebbe meritato attenzione. L'epoca di bilanci, che segna sempre un anniversario, ci ha indotto a riorganizzare e pubblicare un catalogo, ed è un catalogo veramente ricchissimo, che segna, dicevo, e che rappresenta il significato che Vita e Pensiero ha avuto non solo per questa università, ma per la storia della cultura di questo paese. È stata una University Press pionieristica per l'Italia. Oxford e Cambridge ce le hanno dal XV e dal XVI secolo, hanno capito che doveva essere strumento per l'università, strumento per l'elaborazione e la diffusione della cultura, perché questa è l'idea, non solo luogo di insegnamento, luogo di elaborazione di cultura e di diffusione, di distribuzione del sapere. Quando nasce Vita e Pensiero, nasce con un progetto anche di ritorno. Siamo, come ovvio, tra gli anni 10 e 20, l'università sarebbe nata 3 anni dopo, siamo in un periodo di ritorno dei cattolici con la loro identità piena e dichiarata nel dibattito culturale, nel dibattito politico. Uno dei tanti canali è certamente stato anche l'editrice Vita e Pensiero, prima con la rivista e poi con, appunto, l'attività editoriale, che ci vede peraltro stare su un mercato, quindi chiamati anche a compiere delle scelte di efficienza economica, delle scelte di individuazione dei testi, perché nel catalogo ci sono esempi significativi di opere importanti, anche curiose. Ho scoperto di recente, già l'ho ricordato, che il primo volume pubblicato è un saggio di Monsignor Olgiati su Carlo Marx, che all'epoca significa voler davvero essere sul confine della dialettica, è fin scontato dirlo, del dibattito culturale, prendendo delle posizioni molto chiare, ma soprattutto sorretto dall'approccio di tipo scientifico. Oggi, nei tempi più recenti, l'editrice, oltre a pubblicare i volumi dei docenti dell'università, ha saputo intercettare autori moderni, autori contemporanei, autori che avevano qualcosa da dire, sono qui presenti, nel dibattito culturale. La loro originalità fa sì che l'Università Cattolica, attraverso l'editrice, possa dire pienamente di essere un soggetto vivo, vitale, presente e significativo nel contesto culturale, non solo di questo paese, ma con grande attenzione anche, lo dimostrano i relatori di questa mattina, a ciò che avviene al di fuori, ai percorsi della cultura mondiale contemporanea. Oggi, dicevo, però, si è deciso non di volgere retrospettivamente lo sguardo alla ricostruzione storica, ma di fare quello che un'università e un editore meglio devono fare: riflettere, studiare, pensare, condividere le riflessioni, i risultati delle proprie speculazioni intellettuali. E questo lo si fa soprattutto con una scelta molto felice, spostando ulteriormente la prospettiva dall'editore, da quello che produce il testo industrialmente, o dall'autore, da quello che lo pensa, al lettore, a colui che è destinatario del testo, dell'opera editoriale, dell'opera scientifica. Ora, sapendo e riflettendo in particolare questa mattina su un dato che è molto importante e sul quale in questa università si sta provando ad avviare una meditazione, cioè sul modo in cui sta cambiando la relazione dialettica tra il testo e il lettore, per il fatto che sta cambiando il mezzo. Ora, citare McLuhan sarebbe scontato. In realtà c'è qualcosa di più. Noi siamo di fronte, evidentemente, alla più importante modificazione, ad un processo di modificazione del testo, dell'essenza materiale del testo, radicale quanto direi lo fu l'invenzione della stampa. Perché, sappiamo cosa ha significato, di nuovo, dopo secoli di riflessione sul rapporto tra il lettore e il testo stampato, abbiamo ora da pensare a come funziona il rapporto tra il lettore e un testo digitalizzato, che è un testo diverso, che trasmette il suo contenuto in modo differente, più rapido, multiforme, ma anche inevitabilmente esposto al rischio della superficialità dell'approccio. Di questo si è da molte parti consapevoli. Nello stesso Instrumento un laboris che è stato preparato per il Sinodo, si dice, cito, l'irruzione delle tecnologie digitali sta cominciando ad avere impatti profondissimi sulla nozione di tempo e di spazio, sulla percezione di sé e degli altri del mondo, sul modo di comunicare, di apprendere e di informarsi. Un tale approccio alla realtà finisce per privilegiare l'immagine rispetto all'ascolto e alla lettura e sta modificando il modo di imparare e lo sviluppo del senso critico. E non è per una volta il lamento del vecchio professore o del professore che sta invecchiando che si duole del mutare dell'atteggiamento degli studenti che non sono più solerti, diligenti come si era un tempo noi. Non è vero. La realtà è che però bisogna rendersi conto che il modo, e gli studi di Marianne Wolff chiaramente lo dimostrano insieme a quelli di altri, il modo di confrontarsi col testo, il modo di apprendere, il modo non solo di immagazzinare nozioni, ma di porsi in relazione al messaggio che si riceve, sta mutando perché muta il modo di accesso a questi messaggi. Giuliano Vigini, in un articolo che è stato pubblicato sulla nostra rivista recentemente, osservava che la capacità di favorire, meglio degli altri strumenti digitali, quella lettura profonda, comprensione, ragionamento, riflessione, analisi critica e meditazione, attraverso la quale il bagaglio cognitivo si completa, si rafforza e si estende, è qualcosa che abbiamo elaborato sulla base del testo scritto, del testo statico, leggibile, rileggibile, rispetto al quale si può risalire. Rimane questa capacità nei testi attuali, nei modi attuali di confrontarsi con i testi, in un mondo che è stato dimostrato scrive moltissimo, scrive sempre di più, ma legge sempre di meno. E sempre dedicando meno tempo alla lettura. Allora, se, come diceva Valéry, leggere significa vivere dove conducono le parole, dobbiamo comprendere se noi e se soprattutto le nuove generazioni ne siamo ancora capaci di fronte alla sostituzione dell'immagine allo scritto, di fronte alla sostituzione dello scritto che resta tra le mani a lungo con lo scritto che appare e poi scompare dal video di un computer. In conclusione viene da ricordare la frase che si trova molto spesso citata in Lector in Fabula di Eco, che definisce il testo un meccanismo pigro che vive sul plusvalore di senso immessovi dal destinatario. Ebbene, se pensiamo alla filosofia, alla semeiotica, all'ermeneutica di questi anni ci hanno condotto attraverso i percorsi sinusoidali o circolari della relazione tra il testo e il lettore protagonista del testo, ma deve essere questo protagonista un lettore che dal testo si fa catturare, che si fa coinvolgere, che accetta di assorbirlo in sé. Ora, è ancora questa la caratteristica del lettore contemporaneo, del lettore dell'epoca digitale? La domanda è proprio questa. In queste giornate non riflettiamo, non ricordiamo i fasti della nostra editrice, che pur vi sono, non descriviamo i progetti futuri, che altrettanto sono solidi, ma ci chiediamo, e mi pare scelta felice, qual è il lettore che si sta costruendo in questi anni e come egli sta cambiando, perché il mutamento del lettore muterà anche il mutamento della cultura e del modo di trasmissione della cultura. Quindi vi ringrazio per essere venuti a festeggiare la nostra rivista, ringrazio nuovamente i relatori, con una sincerità per me rara dico che mi spiace molto dover abbandonare, di non poter sentire tutte le relazioni, ma avrò la prima lezione del mio corso e almeno alla prima è giusto che mi presenti per non dare eccessiva delusione agli studenti. In seguito farò loro il regalo di qualche ora libera, ma per oggi dovrò andare, quindi mi scuso se non potrò trattenermi per l'intera mattinata e auguro a tutti buon lavoro.
Che senso ha celebrare un anniversario? In particolare un anniversario così tondo e importante come un secolo di vita. Non è una domanda retorica, soprattutto oggi. È infatti esperienza comune l'illanguidirsi del sentimento del tempo, personale e collettivo, l'illanguidirsi del sentimento del provenire da un passato che ci precede e ci fonda e dell'aprirsi a un futuro nel quale lasciare un segno. Viviamo immersi in una successione di attimi, spesso senza relazione tra di loro. E tuttavia i compleanni si festeggiano per le persone e per le istituzioni. Magari non sempre siamo consapevoli del perché festeggiamo, ma è importante festeggiare. E se siamo qui oggi a festeggiare i 100 anni di Vita e Pensiero, è perché riconosciamo di venire da una lunga storia fatta da coloro che ci hanno preceduto, con la loro intelligenza e passione, con il loro lavoro e la loro perseveranza. Siamo qui anche perché confidiamo di consegnare qualcosa a coloro che verranno dopo di noi. È il meraviglioso legame tra le generazioni che va coltivato con determinazione. Di questa storia che ci precede siamo ammirati e grati, come sempre quando si riceve un dono. Ma grati di che cosa? Grati di quello che è stato al principio e che poi, in diversi modi e toni, ha dato vitalità a questa storia che ha attraversato il tempo. Immaginatevi il 1918, quando è nata l'editrice. Il paese era ancora nel pieno della Prima Guerra Mondiale, la prima grande mattanza causata dal connubio tra guerra e tecnologia. Immaginiamo le sue macerie fisiche e morali, immaginiamo anche la miseria economica in cui si trovava il paese. E consideriamo anche la povertà culturale e politica del cattolicesimo all'inizio del secolo, come prima ricordava il rettore. In questo quadro alcuni uomini e una donna, padre Gemelli, Monsignor Olgiati, Armida Barelli, osano puntare sulla forza delle idee per ricostruire un futuro. Nel 1914 fondano la rivista Vita e Pensiero, che poi dà il nome all'editrice, che nasce appunto nel 18, e nel 21 nascerà l'università. E c'è da essere quindi grati di quella passione e di quell'entusiasmo degli inizi, di questa fiducia nella forza delle idee. A leggere i racconti degli inizi saremmo tentati nel nostro disincanto di considerare ingenua quella fiducia e sbaglieremmo. Quel principio, quell'inizio, ha dato forma e vitalità ad una storia che ci ha portato fin qui. La domanda è allora: come essere all'altezza di questa eredità? Come reinvestirla? È la nostra parte di responsabilità oggi. Abbiamo infatti la responsabilità e il dovere di che questa storia si estenda negli anni a venire e venga consegnata vitale e gravida di futuro alle prossime generazioni. È una storia che deve continuare ad essere generativa. E come? Onorando il binomio che dà nome all'editrice, un binomio che potrebbe apparire anch'esso un po' ingenuo, un po' démodé nella sua pretenziosità, il binomio vita e pensiero. Eppure, a ben pensarci, che forza e che lucidità nell'intuizione della scelta di quel binomio. Sappiamo bene che nella mentalità comune è oggi assai diffuso un pregiudizio anti-intellettualistico nei confronti della cultura e soprattutto nella cultura nella sua forma alta. Magari questo discredito ha qualche buona ragione quando la cultura diventa autoreferenziale. Ma il pensiero, quando è veramente tale, è pensiero della vita. Dalla vita viene e alla vita è destinato. Quando è così, il pensiero viene apprezzato e soprattutto dai giovani. È quindi questa la nostra parte di eredità e di responsabilità come editrice: riferirci a questo preciso momento storico-culturale in cui viviamo, farcene interrogare, dare parola all'esperienza dell'oggi per capirla e per orientarci in un cambiamento d'epoca così radicale come il nostro. Stare dentro la transizione con consapevolezza di ciò che sta accadendo. E allora è su questo sfondo che abbiamo pensato di onorare il centenario, riflettendo su un fenomeno che ci tocca da vicino come editrice, appunto come cambia il lettore nella società digitale. Potrebbe sembrare un tema circoscritto, magari di interesse soltanto per il mondo degli addetti ai lavori. In realtà, come ricordava prima il rettore, è uno snodo importante per la cultura tutta. Se cambia la testa del lettore, letteralmente, la cosa cambia tutto, cambia la cultura tutta, non solo l'editoria libraria, non solo i giornali, ma anche la scuola, l'università e anche la politica. Di questo parleremo oggi e negli eventi che in altre sedi articoleranno le celebrazioni del centenario fino al 18 di novembre. Avete trovato sui vostri banchi il programma completo. L'auspicio è che questi eventi suscitino un dibattito su un tema tanto importante quanto trascurato nell'opinione pubblica. Vorrei terminare questo mio intervento introduttivo con alcuni ringraziamenti davvero non di circostanza. Il grazie va anzitutto all'Università, di cui Vita e Pensiero è appunto University Press, che molto ha supportato questo centenario attraverso il lavoro di molte persone e soprattutto attraverso il convinto sostegno e apprezzamento del rettore. Un grande grazie va anche alle colleghe e al collega dell'editrice. In editrice ci sono quasi soltanto donne, come avviene ormai nell'editoria. Il loro competente apporto è semplicemente essenziale per continuare questa storia. E un grazie di cuore va a Marianne Wolf, a Miguel Benassayag, a Pablo Dors, a Carlo Ossola, che hanno accolto l'invito ad inaugurare le celebrazioni del centenario. Non sono solo autori di Vita e Pensiero, sono anche amici a cui ci lega una sensibilità e un'ispirazione comune. grazie anche di questo. E allora iniziamo, per così dire, la festa del secolo, passando la parola a Marion Wolf, neuroscienziata cognitivista di fama internazionale. Ha insegnato per molti anni a Tufts University di Boston. Da poche settimane si è trasferita a Los Angeles, dove insegna alla UCLA. Autrice di Proust e il calamaro, pubblicato nel 2008, che l'ha fatta conoscere come uno dei massimi esperti sul cervello che legge, a 10 anni di distanza ha pubblicato negli Stati Uniti e in contemporanea presso Vita e Pensiero, poche settimane fa, un altro libro, Lettore, vieni a casa, il cervello che legge in un mondo digitale. Un libro per il grande pubblico che sta già suscitando un importante dibattito negli States. Le siamo molto riconoscenti per aver ispirato con questo libro il tema del centenario.
Buongiorno, buongiorno, esteemed guest, honored clergy and rhetore, and all of you dear good readers. Mi dispiace, non parli italiano. Vorrei parlare italiano. Vorrei essere milanese. And now I want to show you where I live. Before I begin, I need to tell you a few thanks for several people. Well, this is interesting. The Me Too movement would have troubles with that, but I want to thank my friend, my colleague, Aurelio Maria Mottola, whom when I first corresponded, thought he was a woman, because Maria. But I came to know, and through this celebration, came to realize this is the crowning achievement of not only Vita and Pensiero, in my opinion, but the most generative act a publisher can give the world. The use of knowledge, the use of wisdom, and the use of virtuous action to cause debate, dialogue, and discussion. I remember Rettore with you and Gabriella Forti. Where is he? Where's he here? He better be here. Wherever he is. We had a conversation about the changes to language, to written language. Today's talk is about humanism, about science, about technology, and about the aspiration of the human spirit at this moment. I believe Dr. Mottola, with the unbelievable aid of Valania Lamandola and the incredible support of the Sacra Familia Mottola family, Rosella, Leo, Fra, and Sophie, and Stephanie, all of these people are part of what happens today. So when I look at you, and I look at my esteemed speakers who I share this with, whose work I not only honor, but will quote in certain ways, we are the future. And my talk today is a story, if you will. But stories have mysteries, and they have challenges, and they have dark places. They have cautionary aspects. And so this story will have cautionary aspects. But at the end, like John Steinbeck, I want you to realize, at the end, there is light. And that's the arc of my talk that will take us in several places that many of you perhaps might even be uncomfortable with. A lot of my students don't want to learn about the brain. You might not, but it does not matter. We are going to do that together, but I have one last thanks before my story begins. There are two people who have traveled the furthest to come to this talk and who have overcome extraordinary physical challenges. I refer to my dearest friends, Professor Thomas Bally and Heidi Bally from the heart of Switzerland, who've come here today. So I thank you both for coming. And now, what do we do with this knowledge? E.M. Forster, and you'll hear, this talk is as much about literature and poetry as science. He said, only connect. This is, in a certain sense, what is so necessary today in this series of talks that will be a month of arts and culture and music and science. Bringing it all together, and that's what my work does. We are invested in bringing our understanding of the way the brain works with how we live our lives. And one of the most important things that I do today is to give you a very brief understanding of why we have to think almost like a Proustian pause, this moment in our history, in order that we understand why we should be worried about a changing reading brain. Now, Professor Mottola, Dr. Mottola said that I've written a book. I wrote a book for the public of letters. It was based somewhat on Italo Calvino's 6 essays for the next millennium, and it was also on my own history studying Rilke, Rainer Maria Rilke, in which he wrote to a stranger. And you are strangers, but the relationship between author and reader is one in which we attempt to have a dialogue with you who know more about some things than we ever will. And so even my talk, my book and my talk, is about letters in a dialogue. And I use Calvino for many reasons, but one of the things that he said in his 6 essays was, in an age when fantastically speedy, widespread media are triumphing and running the risk of flattening all communication onto a single homogeneous surface, we need a rhythm of time that passes with no other aim than to let feelings and thoughts settle down, mature, and shed all impatience or ephemeral contingency. There will be two leitmotifs that we share, Miguel and I, and that's the role of time. What have we done with the economy of time that we possess? In the interest of efficiency to gain time, we have lost the very meaning of it too often. So Calvino reminds us that there is a contemplative dimension to the reader that will be a leitmotif in my talk today. The other aspect that has influenced my work is the work of Proust, in particular, about talking about what is reading. And he said it is that fertile miracle of communication effected in solitude. We can be totally by ourselves and yet enter into the lives of others. But there's a second aspect, he said. We feel quite truly that our wisdom begins where that of the author leaves off. In an age when we are buffeted by information, I ask you to remember the poet T.S. Eliot, who said, "Where is the wisdom lost in knowledge? Where is the knowledge lost in information?" So what I hope is to enter even in one 55-minute time with you, a dialogue where, like Proust, I hope my thoughts elicit yours, and like Thomas Aquinas, iron sharpens iron. My thoughts, I hope, will sharpen yours, and your reactions in whatever life you live will help sharpen the entirety. But we live in a very important moment, a hinge moment. The historian from Harvard, Robert Darnton, used that term. We are straddling, just as oral communication became literate communication. We now are a literacy culture that is on the way to fully becoming a digital culture. The difference, and I speak especially to the students and the young people who will be researchers, the difference between this hinge moment and the past is that we have the science, the technology, and I hope the wisdom to know how to choose what cognitive processes we will use in the future. And I need to underscore, reading is not just something to be taken for granted in school. Reading, literacy changes the brain. This changes the individual, which changes society, which ultimately changes the future of our species. It is never to be taken for granted. There is another important point that I need us to begin with together as a shared assumption. We do not need ever more to speak in binaries. I know on your public radio, there was a program and they were saying, oh, this kind of work is old-fashioned. Old-fashioned is to consider these issues binaries. It is not digital versus print. It is not old, traditional, conventional versus innovative. It is a matter of cognitive choice about what processes different mediums advantage or actually atrophy. We are in charge, just as Rattori said, of our future, but we have to be informed about that future. So my loving task is to help you understand why and what that choice incorporates. So it begins with this innocent little sentence. The human brain was never born to read. We were born to speak, to see, to taste. Reading does not exist in the programs of the brain. It's an epigenetic achievement. We human beings create circuits. We create circuits for new cognitive functions. But it means when it's not programmed that it's plastic. And that plasticity has an implication that's very important for you to understand. There is no one circuit. Those of you who speak Chinese and Japanese, you use different areas of your brain. You have universal things we share, but the circuit changes according to the writing system, according to how it's instructed. Daniela Trafficante, somewhere you're out there, she is in part of the research on how instruction changes the minds of children. But in addition, the medium. We are reflecting in how our circuit develops the affordances, advantages, and disadvantages of different mediums. And we're not only talking about two mediums. You, who will do the research of this future, we're going to have many more mediums than just what we're talking about today. But
by and large, we develop this beautiful circuitry that uses so much of the brain. And usually I use a man with a frontal exposed lobe for this demonstration. I'm not going to do it, but I have many candidates I could, and it would have been wonderful. But I have to be very serious today, so I'm going to only say that that reading brain can be very basic. It can be an information processor, or, and this is the beauty, it can involve an entirety. I use his brain, the entirety of the human brain. That was good. This is not what people understand. The brain elaborates. It's organic. The more you read, the more you build. The less you read, the less elaborated it becomes. And one of the quotes Rotori gave was from someone who talked about deep reading. Well, deep reading is at the very heart. It's what Proust was talking about. But it's very much more beautiful and complicated than we ever knew. And it involves processes that go from background knowledge, how we build knowledge, forms a foundation for making analogies. When you read any passage, any psalm, any part of any gospel, any beautiful novel, you are taking what you know at that moment in time and making an analogy to it. But what would happen if you don't have that background knowledge? If you aren't building it, you don't make the analogy, and then what I call the scientific method processes of deep reading are not elicited. Inference. How do we infer the truth of a statement? Deduction, induction. We also have one of the more beautiful aspects of deep reading that is not sufficiently understood and studied. But I've just come back from Norway, where there's a whole group of people who are looking at the evolution of reading, who are studying it. And it's this ability to be transported when we read, to take on the perspective of another. Whether we are a little child learning what the feelings of another are, whether we are a student learning the historical lives of others, or whether we are simply learning about other who is so different, this is the basis of empathy. And I'm going to just give you one quick look at, I'll come back to this. Barack Obama, I won't say what I wish. You can't infer what I wish. Barack Obama went to our novelist, Marilyn Robinson, and he went there because he said, you and the novel teaches about empathy. That life is not gray and white. It's about understanding who other is. That, from a neuroscience viewpoint, is the basis for understanding theories of other's mind. Machiavelli was the preeminent theorist of other minds. But we, when we take on perspectives, do two things. We have a theory of another's mind, and we have feeling. We have empathy, the basis of compassion. The novelist in America, Jane Smiley, when asked whether the novel was dead, said no, but it could be sidelined, put aside. And then we would have leaders. We would have people who have no real comprehension of other. And if we have leaders who have no sense of who other is, it is an invitation to barbarism, the opposite of humanism. To this, Marilyn Robinson said, the trend towards seeing those different as sinister other is the greatest threat to our democracy. It is this spirit of what the novel gives us that I return to someone who is your last speaker. You have such a beautiful program. Alberto Manguel said this about what we build in background knowledge. Reading is cumulative and proceeds with geometric progression. Each new reading builds upon what came before. You will have a wonderful moment with Alberto Manguel, but I also want to quote the theologian John Donne on empathy. He said, it is like the golden key. It's the capacity to pass over to others. We lose an extraordinary capacity for passing over to others when the novel and books like the novel are read less and less. It is an extremely important wake-up call to all of us about the purpose. Now, I use Thomas Aquinas for this picture to show, instead of Miguel's brain, how much is used with the entirety of the deep reading circuit. Those who say we only use one part of our brain have never studied the reading brain. And Thomas Aquinas, in his inimitable way, knew this. When asked, this is in G.K. Chesterton's biography, when Thomas Aquinas was asked what he was most grateful for, he said, I am most grateful that I understood every page I ever read. What a beautiful statement. What a beautiful goal for the future of a publishing cooperation between university and a press. If there's any model that I wish for, it's such a connection rhetore between the knowledge that we possess and those who will publish and give it generatively away. But it takes time. And you're going to hear more of this in the next talk. But from my standpoint, at a cognitive level, it takes years to form deep reading. And it takes extra seconds, milliseconds, and choice by us to do this. What? You can't hear? What? Oh, well, I'll just keep going. can you hear me, everyone? Am I too loud? Sometimes I'm too loud. Excitement makes me louder. So I'll keep it down. The point of teaching you about the reading brain circuit is that it will, because of its neuroplasticity, always reflect the affordances of whatever medium. My colleague at UCLA said this, every medium has its costs and weaknesses. Every medium develops some skills at the expense of others. The internet may develop impressive visual intelligence. The cost seems to be deep processing, mindful knowledge, inductive analysis, critical thinking, imagination, and reflection. The role of time. We must have time to allocate to those deep reading processes. We know about them, but we are in an age when we are not aware, we're not using them as much. The reason, and it's part of questions that we are asking, the real question is whether affordances of reading on screen lead us to a new normal for reading, one in which length and complexity and memory and concentration are proving more challenging. There is a great deal of evidence. If I had all day with you, You would be unhappy. I would be happy. I could go through all the evidence, but today I'm going to go through only a little. The first is that from the eye movement research, we're skimmers. We are skimming more words, 50 to 100,000 words a day. Think of it, 50 to 100,000, but we're skimming. We use an F pattern or a Z pattern. But what goes missing is that we're word spotting. We're missing the sequence often of the details that help us understand. We spend less concentrated time. Our youth are distracted 27 times an hour. Where does concentration come when we are so distracted? The reality is that we are living in a time in which I call it a digital chain hypothesis, when the amount of information paradoxically makes us actually read less concentratedly in places that give us alternative viewpoints. We go to the more familiar, the comfortable, the less cognitive challenging. This has real consequences. So how much we read changes how we read. We become skimmers, word spotters. That in turn changes what we read. We often read quicker, briefer praises. We triage, we give it away. My one son who works at Google said, "Mom, you don't realize you are also being narrowed in what you read by the choices you are given often in some of our different sources." And that in turn can have an effect on what is written. Think about the student writing. Now, as long as I've taught, people have worried about student writing. But it is getting worse. And I believe a part of it is this Twitter brain mentality. The idea that you can reduce complexity so much that it can fit in these brief bursts. That in turn influences the very heart of why we're here, why we read. This is one of the most important questions of the entire month. Reading can be the most beautiful vehicle to the transport of our thoughts, our ideas, but we must have time for the critical analysis that is at the end of the deep reading process. And here is where I'm going to insist upon two important points. Deep reading has all these processes, but at the end of them are two essential ones. Critical analysis that we can use to evaluate, and empathy. Together, it is like our brain is poetry and science. That brain needs both in order to reach the acme, which is insight and novel thought. Why we read is being threatened, paradoxically, because we have so much information that we are skimming and using unadjudicated sources, which actually means we have less exposure to alternative perspectives, less understanding of other. And so we have implications that are very important. If we reduce the time we give deep reading processes, we will have less time for the complexity of the issues that confront us. We will have less ability to understand other. Here we are in this beautiful hall, in this seat of knowledge and wisdom. We will have less time to perceive beauty, the careful choices. And here I will relate this to conversations that Dr. Mottola and his family and the Ballys and I have had. What does it mean to the transmission of cultural heritage when we are skimming? Well, Italo Calvino said this, And it was very important. We said this, Rettore, with Dean Forti. This quote, we both tried to find it. And here it is. Oops. Oh. Success consists in felicity, a verbal expression which every so often may result from a quick flash of inspiration, but as a rule involves a patient search for the mot juste, for the sentence in which every word is unalterable. What will we lose if we word spot that sentence alone? And if we have individuals with less deep reading, what does it mean for society if critical analysis and empathy atrophy? We will have less attention to others' viewpoints, especially in the United States, I must say this. We will have more susceptibility to false information, being unable to judge 62% to 82% of our high school students cannot tell the difference between fact and an advertisement. This is an enormously important aspect. Oh, dear, 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 dear. Finally, if all of this is happening, and it's not, it is a process. We need to know about what it is that we see happening in our research, what the implications are, because all of this ultimately threatens democracy. Democracy, and I use your beautiful, the book by Umberto Eco and Cardinal Carlo Maria Martini. Cardinal Martini said this, the delicate game of democracy provides for a dialectic of opinions in the hope that such exchange will expand the collective moral conscience that is the basis for orderly cohabitation. Democracy requires all of our differences. Iron sharpens iron. We need to know other perspectives in much more detail and nuance than we are. And now I very quickly, for just 5 minutes, want to give you some of the research on children, since this is a very special part of what my work is. The reality is that I work with pediatricians, and the iPad's the new pacifier, the new babysitter. There are good news and bad news, but it's more bad for language development. We do studies. We study the brains of children who are being read to. And what we find is that the more children are read tactile books, not screens, the better their language, both expressively and receptively. And if you compare a parent reading a book versus an audio version versus a screen like a cartoon of that same story, the parent, that is what best increases the language activation. We have so many studies clinically that are showing that our children are so distracted that they are hyper. They need more stimulation. They need their hands working. They need to have multitasking. There are some very good things about that. No doubt our children and our youth can do multitasking better, but the reality of multitasking is very complicated. Not for today's talk, but by and large, multitasking is only the surface of the task and not going below it. And so we have a lot of studies in what is a very new group in Europe called the eRead Network, which is the study of reading in a digital age, funded by the Council on Science and Technology in Europe. And we now have, I was just at their meeting giving them a talk, and we just have the latest study, which is showing 171 participants, 171,000 participants in studies from the year 2000 till now. And what you are seeing is that the students believe they are doing better on a screen, but they aren't. We need to know this. We need to know why. Their comprehension for detail, for plot, for sequencing across all of these genres, across time conditions, is simply complexly, but better for print. What does that mean for all of us? It is especially the case that these results get stronger closer to now. That's not what I would have thought. I would have thought the more digital native, the weaker the effect. It's the stronger effect. No doubt, in part, because the skimming type of reading is giving them less formation of deep reading processes. The reality is that our children are spending only 16%, only 16% of them are reading a magazine or a book a day, whereas it was 60% not that long ago. Where does this leave us? Now, I need to know exactly where it leaves me in time. Hold on. How many minutes? 10? How many? Oh, good. Great. Okay. The questions for our youth are extremely important. I'm going to give them as a bridge to the questions for us. If we have changes in attention that are going on, this constant distractibility, and for those of you who are biologists or psychologists or neuroscientists, we are programmed by our evolution to have a novelty reflex. Whatever is new, we look at. It's the basis of survival, prey or predator. So when children who don't have an inhibitory system matured, they are willy-nilly attracted, always. And so they are becoming more and more susceptible to distraction and learning to concentrate less in ways that we want in the beginning. This, in turn, I worry, will threaten them building a storehouse of knowledge, what I call background knowledge. If our children have less knowledge in them, consolidated, and attention and memory are very, very connected, we will have less of a basis for them to know what they don't know. They won't have an analogy to make, oh, that's false. Oh, I don't believe that. We have to be constantly building at the same time, learning to use the external platforms of knowledge. So I'm hoping that we will learn from the ongoing research that we must simultaneously be building that internal platform and adding to it, but in a very careful way, where we are not becoming so over-reliant that we are delegating our intelligence to unadjudicated sources of knowledge. Okay? So if that happens, and this is an if background becomes increasingly threatened, inference, critical analysis will decline. And they will become much more susceptible to false information, which we already know. They are becoming much more susceptible. But in this hall, in this university, in Vitam Pensiero, the question also becomes, will they be less able to have the cognitive patience? Is it pacienza? Pacienza. Cognitiva pacienza. To read more complex work. Our literature professors in many places are worrying that our students want briefer short stories rather than the novels of the 19th and the 20th century. Hemingway and George Eliot are equal to me, but I want our students able to read both. We need to have graphic novels, and we need to have the ability, the cognitive patience, to read complicated works of our culture. So I will, this part of my talk, I will end and then go to adulthood. But the end of this part of the talk, two slides, two words. Preserve as we expand. Never think in terms of binaries, one or the other.
And I have been developing a plan or a proposal in this new work for what I call a biliterate brain, in which, in the beginning, just like Piaget, the sensory motor aspects of the child are being used as the basis for learning print, learning deep reading with tactile, embodied cognition, and you will hear much more about that. The embodiment of knowledge is what I hope in the beginning. Simultaneously, around five, especially, around five, I want our children to be using the screen for coding, for programming, for their whole visual intelligence, which is so important that they build. It is not either or, it is both. But it is careful, it's developmental, it looks at the characteristics of the medium and the purposes of the reading. You too. I look at you. He's a reader, but I'm looking at it with a good reason. We need to know the purpose for which we read. If I read deep reading for all the email I received, I would be catatonic. There are modes of reading that are for different purposes. We need our children to learn those purposes and their individual differences. Half of my work also in neuroscience is in dyslexia. One of the most beautiful brains there ever was, and undoubtedly in my mind, Leonardo da Vinci was dyslexic. Undoubtedly for me, and I've got a lot of reasons why. There are different minds that require different mediums, so it's not one and only one recipe, but it's an attempt to think about these variables. So ultimately, I want deep reading to be available to our children across mediums. They learn deep reading with print. They learn it, and then they're carefully taught. Our professional development is a really important part of this. They're carefully taught deep reading instead of like you and me, willy-nilly on the screen. So it's a much more careful, explicit use. But now I turn to us. Who is the good reader today? Philosophy, poetry, novelist, these are my friends in this part of this last part of the talk. Aristotle, which I know so many of you know better than I, gave three lives for the good society. The first life is the life of productivity and knowledge, and we all are using reading in that way. The second life of a good society is the life of the Greek sense of leisure and entertainment. But the third life that Aristotle emphasized was the contemplative life. And my teacher and theologian, John Donne, stated that among the three lives of the good society, we have a life of action and a life of enjoyment. But for the most part, we are lacking a life of contemplation with dire consequences. The analogy from Aristotle's good society is what I draw for the good reader. We are awash in the productive uses of reading. It is a fantastic moment for information and productivity. We are also awash in entertainment, and this is a fantastic moment for that. But I believe we are departing every day from the contemplative last portion of the reading act, in which it is contemplation and reflection that moves critical analysis and empathy into insight of our own novel thought, sometimes for many people. This is the moment when we as a society need to think about the time it takes for contemplation, for reflection. And I turn to friends, and someone asked me, who's in this audience, why in my last letter I had so many friends, and you will see why. David Ulin said this about the contemplative life: to read, we need a certain kind of silence, a biography of silence, perhaps, that you will hear about this afternoon, that seems increasingly elusive in our over-network society. And it is not contemplation we seem to desire, but an odd sort of distraction masquerading as being in the know. Remember Walter Benjamin's statement that news is over the day it's printed. In such a landscape, knowledge can't help but fall prey to illusion, that speed can lead us to illumination that is more important, we think, to react than to think deeply. Reading, at its best, is an act of contemplation, an act of resistance in a landscape of distraction. It returns us to a reckoning with time. I look at time in one way. My colleague Miguel looks at time in a neurobiological and a cultural way. We all must examine time in our lives. I look finally in the last three slides at what reading is to me and to others. I finally decided that what reading is for me is my home. It is, for Marcus Aurelius, the invisible citadel. For Marcel Proust, it's a miracle of communication. And for our colleague Carlo Ossola, who will be here this afternoon, his beautiful review, you can read it in Italian, in this invisible kingdom, one must continue to make a home. You build a home. A home isn't just given. You build a home. Reading and constructing books as true and welcoming abodes of the future. That's what I want for our youth. I don't want them to do V's and S's and F's and Z's when they read. I want them to know how to do that, but how to have the feeling of transportation to the home, the holding ground, as Philip Davis sometimes says. And I turn also to one of my favorite friends, whom I've never met, of course, Dietrich Bonhoeffer, who carried the books Goethe, Plutarch, and the Bible to the place where he was executed. But his parents managed to take books to him, and he read all of these books, not just to himself, not just to his fellow prisoners, but to his prison guards, because he knew and believed that reading was one of the places where we're not all together, we're united somewhere in aspiration. And he wrote this, passages from the Bible books, all are invested with life and reality. I live in a great unseen realm of whose real existence is no doubt. As a cognitive neuroscientist, I study materialism, right? But I believe in that invisible realm, whether we can define it or find a brain activation pattern or not. My other favorite friend in the United States is the Pulitzer-winning novelist Marilyn Robinson. We stand at a threshold, as Bonhoeffer did, and the example of his life obliges me to speak about the gravity of our historical moment in the knowledge that no society is at any time immune to moral catastrophe. We owe it to him to acknowledge that these challenges can be understood too late. I am talking about a story today with challenges to us, but challenges that have solutions when science and humanism and technology can help redress the weaknesses of the thing itself. We owe it not just to ourselves, we owe it to our children. And here in my last two slides, I quote Martha Nussbaum. It would be catastrophic to become a nation of technically competent people who have lost the ability to think critically, to examine themselves, to respect the humanity and diversity of others. And unless we support these endeavors, it is in such a nation that we may well live. It is therefore urgent to support efforts aimed at producing citizens who can take charge of their own reasoning, who can see the different and foreign, not as a threat to be resisted, but as an invitation to expand their own minds and capacity for citizenship. I look and think about what Pope Francis says about not building walls, but bridges. We who live in the world of ideas across all mediums, this is our moment to preserve what Martha Nussbaum is saying, to have both technical competence and a moral imagination. So finally, we come to the end. And my message to you in this future, this look at the future, is one of joy. I am not depressed by this knowledge. I'm exhilarated that we have the knowledge from which we can become not just better readers, but if we're better readers, better thinkers, better people. The discernment of truth and wisdom, the turning of contemplation into virtue and action. And I will say, this month-long experience of events is what I consider contemplation in action. I hope all of you, I wish I could be with you all month. But all of this will depend on the allocation of time we give the full range of cognitive, affective, and moral processes underlying them in ourselves and in the next generation. Reading changes the brain, changes the mind, which affects that glittering instrument, the human soul, which affects humankind. I give you choice. This time, this hinge moment, let us choose with all our intelligence. Godspeed. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you for staying. Thank you. Appreciate this.
Oh my goodness. Grazie, Marianne, per questo lucido, appassionato intervento. Non c'era modo migliore per iniziare le celebrazioni del centenario, per interpretare anche che cosa significa questo binomio vita e pensiero. Questo è un pensiero che viene dalla vita e alla vita va, e ci invita alla responsabilità.